We are mothers.
We are mothers.
We are mothers.
We're the ones who are stretched thin
and stretched far.
The ones who live on caffeine
and God's grace.
We're the ones whose hearts are walking around outside of our bodies.
We are the women who love children that we didn't birth.
The women who wait to hold the babies we couldn't carry.
And the women who ache for a dream
that sometimes feels unseen.
We're the North Stars
who guide our children home
and welcome them back into the fold,
no matter how far they might have gone.
We are the ones who love this life,
even on the days we don't like it.
Motherhood is harder
and holier
and better than we ever thought.
Some days you want to quit.
Most days you can't imagine your life being anything else.
But becoming a mother changes everything.
And here's the truth
that we all need to be reminded of today.
God chose you.
God chose you
in this time
for your children.
He called you.
He anointed you.
He entrusted you.
He trusts you.
God knew exactly what he was doing
when he gave you your children.
He knew the long nights and the short years.
He knew the long nights and the short years.
He knew the pain
and the incredible joy.
And he knew that there was no better mom for the job
than you.
Today,
we celebrate you.
Today, we honor you
because you carry
one of the hardest
and holiest callings.
You are a mother. You are a mother.
You are a mother.
You are a mother.
I have the privilege and honor and blessing to have my mom in our service. And mom, I don't even know if you remember this, but I was recalling on the way here when I was younger, and we were in Vons, and she had me go get something else on another aisle. Well, I was passing the frozen section, and I realized that the Cool Whip is looking really good. And so she was the next aisle over, and I'm passing I go get the thing that she wanted, but I keep on coming back to the Cool Whip. And so, you know, nobody's in the aisle, so what do you think a kid's gonna do? I open the Cool Whip, and I start taking some, just a whole scoop, you know, like the little Tupperware, and putting it in my mouth. And I have to tell you, it was really good. I mean, it was really good. So I went back for seconds, and so realized that I'm eating, and I'm looking around. And if you ever been to the market, I don't know if they still have them because I don't notice them anymore. You have the mirrors at the top, and literally their office is up there that can look down. But also you can see who's in the next aisle over, and yeah, everybody can attest to the face of a mom. That one face. And so as I have the Cool Whip beard going on, I look up at that mirror, and I see my mom in the next section looking at me, giving me that face. I don't remember anything after that, but it was unbelievable. I just thought about that. You know, I know Mother's Day may bring a flood of different emotions for people. Some are celebrating their moms, and some are missing their moms. Some are trying to forgive their moms, and some are feeling guilty about the moms they weren't. Some are in the thick of being a mom, and some are grieving from a broken relationship with their children. Some moms are experiencing heartbreak over a loss of a child, and some are planning to be a mom. Some are being celebrated as a mom today, and some are painfully reminded of the children they were unable to have. That's a lot in a room, isn't it? This message this morning is for biological moms, stepmoms, grandmothers, aunts, teachers, mentors, spiritual moms, adoptive moms, all the women who have made a positive impact on our lives and still making an impact today. So did you hear that? It's for every woman in here, but I want you to know this too. Men, don't fall asleep. Don't look who's winning on right now on any sports. This is just as applicable to you. It's not about the title. It's about the heart of a woman that is changing lives one heartbeat at a time. Can I say that again?
Listen, it's not about the title. It's about the heart of a woman that is changing lives one heartbeat at a time. No matter what season you're in, my hope is that this message will be encouraging and inspiring to you and that you feel honored.
Proverbs 31:31 says this, mentions how we can honor you. Listen to all three Bible translations. The New International Version says this, honor her for all that her hands have done and let her world bring praise at the city gates. Listen to how the Living Bible says it. Praise her for the many fine things she does. These good deeds of her shall bring her honor and recognition from people of importance. Listen how the Message Bible renders this verse. The woman is to be admired and praised is the woman who lives in the fear of God. Give her everything she deserves. Give her that car. Give her, I didn't say that there. Give her, adorn her life with praises. Moms, women, everybody in this room, listening online, wherever you are, what kind of legacy do you want to leave for your children, your grandchildren, the great-grandchildren, the children that are in your lives, the children you influence? What do you want to pass on to the next generation? Some of you have broken relationships. Even then, you can still be the woman of God right now. If a broken relationship is happening, you know why? Because when that relationship is brought back together, guess what? I hope they see a difference in you. I hope they see Jesus in you. Are you following me so far? What do you want to pass to the next generation? The last thing you want to leave is an ambiguous or pointless legacy. Wouldn't you agree? You don't want to leave that type of legacy where they're trying to guess. I want you to think about a relay race. What's the most important part of a relay race? I think you'll find the answer in this video clip you're about to see. Watch this.
So Great Britain in sixth, the United States in seven, Jamaica on the inside in four. You've got the newly crowned women's 100 meter and 200 meter champions in this race. Final of the women's 4x100 away. Team USA in lane seven, all in blue, third from the right.
Nice start for Desiree Bryan of the United States, but Jamaica off to a great start as well. Shelly-Ann Fraser-Pryce has the baton in her hand, trying to keep pace with the United States down the back stretch.
Look at her go. The red hair, the yellow top, what a leg from Shelly-Ann Fraser-Pryce for Jamaica.
Jamaica, USA, and Great Britain all with a chance with one pass to go. Look at Jamaica now.
Janelle Smith with a brilliant Jackson is just sprinting away. Here comes Dina Asher-Smith for Great Britain. It's Jamaica, Great Britain. It's tight for the United States. The USA gets bronze, but it's Jamaica's gold.
To watch the second leg down the back straight, a real head-to-head between Shelly-Ann Fraser-Pryce. Oh, a real shame just seeing pictures here. The Chinese having all sorts of problems. Oh, they're just showing why their race unfolded.
The most important part of the race is the baton, isn't it? In a relay race, they can't tag each other, they have to pass it on, right? Now think about it for a second. It's the most critical part of the race. It happens three times and each pass impacts the race. When it's done in a smooth, swift manner, listen, precious seconds are gained. Are you seeing that? Precious seconds are gained. When the transition is rough, it slows the pace of both runners and valuable time is lost. Listen, if this baton encompasses everything you're passing on to the next generation, my question this morning is, what's on the baton? Is it smooth? Is it ambiguous? Is it being missed? Can your children or anybody you're influencing, could it actually be seen? Is this something they can actually tangibly see in your life? The baton. If there's one thing I can impress upon you today, it would be this, that you are someone of the most some of the most, you are the someone who has the most impact and influence on people. Your influence is greater and broader than you realize, and it's important that you make the baton passing smooth and swift, because every second is precious, right? Every second. A legacy is about what I'm going to leave behind, what I can do with my life that will outlast my life. That's what a legacy is. One famous leader said this: my mother was the most beautiful woman I ever saw. All I am, I owe to my mom, my mother. I attribute my success in life to the moral, intellectual, and physical education I received from her. That leader was George Washington. The Bible tells us that a younger pastor named Timothy was raised and inspired by his mother Eunice and his grandmother Lois, two great women in the Bible. You see, these women were given credit for bringing up one of the most influential young pastors in biblical history. Check out what Paul writes about Timothy's mom and grandmother. Catch this. First, he talks about Timothy. I remember your genuine faith, Timothy, for you share the faith that first filled your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice. And I know that same faith continues strong in you. You see the baton? In other words, your genuine faith was a result of a genuine faith your mom and grandmother shared with you. Let me share three things you can pass on to the next generation. There might be more, but Andy likes three. Here we go. First thing is this: share the legacy of memories. Share the legacy of memories. Have you ever thought how blessed you are to have a memory? Think about that for a second. To have a memory is a blessing. Memories are a gift. The poet Oscar Wilde wrote this: memory is the diary that we all carry about with us. So what memories do you share? Let me just offer two suggestions. The first suggestion is this: share about God's faithfulness. Let that be part of your memory that you're passing on. Psalm 105 says this: for the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues throughout all generations. In Psalm 119:90, it says your faithfulness continues through all generations. You established the earth and it endures. But here it is, everybody, listen to that. We just read those verses. Somebody wrote those down because they experienced God's faithfulness. Are you hearing that? Can you look back and see how faithful God has been to you? Share those memories. My mom has shared stories of my grandmother always feeding the hungry. She would come home from school and see people on the porch, and my grandmother would be feeding all of them. But I want you to know something about my mom's history. She's one of 12. And sometimes money wasn't always there. But her mom was passing on the baton and said, you know what? God is going to provide for us. She never went hungry. My mom was sharing about God's faithfulness in providing. First suggestion, share about God's faithfulness. Second suggestion, share the stories that molded you. The challenges, the good times, the fun times, the traditions, family times, crazy stunts you did, establishments you're not allowed to be in anymore, all those things. Are you with me on that? Are you guys, hang on everybody, here we go. Listen very carefully. Don't you think Sarah in the Old Testament shared how God started her family at the age of 90? Do you think it was a hidden gem? Well, I'm not gonna tell you about that. I was 90 when I had my first kid. Do you think some of her grandkids and great-great-grandkids still talked about it generations later? I do. What about the moms who crossed the Red Sea holding their children? Don't you think that was a story of God? Don't you think that was a story of God intervening worth retelling all the time? Let me tell you a story. Let me tell you about God's provision. I was walking through on dry land. I was carrying you. And what about the Passover tradition? It must have been incredible for those who lived and experienced it firsthand and then shared the story of why it's a tradition to celebrate the Passover. Or what about the story of Rachel in the Old Testament?
Don't you think she shared when God remembered her, listened to her prayers, and enabled her to have a child after so many years? And let's not forget about Mary, the mother of Jesus. Don't you think she shared the miracle of Jesus' birth with Jesus' siblings? Don't you say, hey, I want to tell you about your, I want to tell you what happened. Oh my goodness. That event changed her life. These are the stories that molded who they were as women. These stories of life are meant to be shared so children can glean from your legacy, learn from your legacy, to bring richness to their lives. You see that? It gives them a colorful picture of what impacted you. The stories of your past will impact them in the present, whether good, bad, fun, weird, smooth, or rocky. You know, it's fascinating that technology can turn 8mm film and VHS into a digital download nowadays. And so my brother-in-law decided to get my father-in-law, my mother-in-law's, all their 8mm and VHS and put them into a DVD and a digital. And so Terry and I were over her house watching these videos, and it was fascinating. What was fascinating is that she's the narrator. My mother-in-law's narrating, oh, this is when this happened. This one, I don't even know who that is. But you know, all those things are happening there. And really, she was looking at some of these, and because my father-in-law passed away, but she's like, you know, I need him to tell me who's on this video. But it was incredible. Share the legacy of personal memories and share about God's faithfulness in your life. Maybe it's just about writing it down. Maybe it's about taking the people you're influencing and say, I want to tell you how faithful God is to me, or and was to me, and continues to be faithful. And let me tell you some memories too. I love when my mom and I get together, she tells me all the stories of when she was a child and what she grew up in and what it was like. The second thing you can pass on to the next generation is this. Live a legacy of a commitment to the Lord. Psalm 89:1 says this, I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. My mouth, I will make your faithfulness known through all generations. In Psalm 22:30-31, posterity, meaning future generations, will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord. They will proclaim his righteousness, declaring to people yet unborn, he has done it. It's making the personal connection known that you have a relationship with God. Are you with me still, everybody? Now listen to this. One indelible memory I have of my mom, and man, I'm telling you about my mom a lot. I honor her. I love my mom. There's one indelible memory I always have of her is sitting in the living room. I'm always coming out of my room when I live there, and she's sitting in the living room, and she's always reading the Bible in the morning. And you know what's cool about it too? Even when she wasn't there reading the Bible, it's indelible right here that as I passed that living room, I saw on the stand right next to her, or on the couch, her Bible. And you know what it told me, everyone? It told me she was living out what was important to her. That was valuable to her. That's a baton worth passing on, isn't it? That you love the Lord, that this is important. This is what I do. This is part of who I am. It's not second, it's not third. It's just part of who I am. It's what I do every day. That legacy is still vivid in my mind. What about you? How is the present generation seeing you live out your commitment to the Lord? And listen to this, my friends. It would be foolish to think you can't start living the legacy today. I started thinking about this too. What about the failures on your record from being a mom? What about the failures? First and foremost, there is a discretion on what to share. Amen? You're not going to share everything, but the discretion. But also this, there's a time, there's a place, and maturity to talk about those failures. Second, you might not be able to dismiss or ignore your past failures, but you can share how you grew and matured from them. Don't let your past define you, everyone. Use your past to move you into a closer relationship with Jesus so it will impact others. Are you seeing that? It's just not about your transformation. It's you passing the baton. I wanted to let you know how much God changed me. Let God's grace and mercy you experience be part of the baton you're passing. Now listen carefully, very carefully on this next thing I'm going to talk to you about. It's not about the mom you had. Stay with me on this. Some of your moms might not have been the best moms. Some of you might have never experienced what other people are like, oh man, I'm blessed to have a mom. And you don't have that idea. You don't know what that feels like. You're still hurt about it. It's not about the mom you had. It's not about the mom you were. Are you hearing me on that? It's not about the mom you were. It's not about the mom you are today. It's about the mom that you can become. Let me say that again. It's not about the woman that was in your life you had. It's not about the woman you were. It's not about the woman you are today. It's about the woman that you can become. Men, it's not about the dad that you had. Are you with me on this? It's always about the dad that you can become. Leave a legacy of commitment to the Lord. Let the next generation see how God transformed you. First thing you can pass on to the next generation, share the legacy of memories. Second thing, pass on to the next generation, live a legacy of commitment to the Lord. Third thing you can pass on to the next generation, express a legacy of wisdom. Let me share a handful of popular mom wisdom you might be familiar with. First, I'm gonna say what she taught you. And then I'm going to give a quote from her. See if you can resonate with this. My mother taught me to appreciate a job well done. My mom would say, if you're going to kill each other, do it outside. I just finished cleaning. My mom taught me about religion. You better pray that will come out of the carpet. My mom taught me logic. Because I said so, that's why. My mom taught me more logic. If you fall out of that tree and break your neck, you're not going to the store with me. My mom taught me irony. Keep crying and I'll give you something to cry about. My mom taught me about behavior modification. I love this. Stop acting like your father. Okay, next. My mother taught me about justice. One day when you have kids, I hope they turn out what? Just like you. My mom taught me wisdom. Hey, when you get to be my age, you'll understand. Yeah. And an unknown author said this about moms, life doesn't come with a manual, it comes with a mother. Another unknown author said this, if at first you don't succeed, try doing it the way your mom told you to at the beginning. Do you want to express a legacy of wisdom? Show everyone where your wisdom comes from. Let me share three sources for wisdom. First source is this, the wisdom from God. Proverbs 2:6 says this, for the Lord gives wisdom and his mouth come knowledge and understanding. Job 12 verse 13 says, to God belongs wisdom and power. Counsel and understanding are his. It's recognizing first and foremost, everyone, nothing can match the wisdom of God. Nothing. You want to leave a legacy by pointing to God's wisdom as the starting point for every situation. Need some wisdom? Ask for it. James 1:5 says this, if you need wisdom, ask our generous God and he will give it to you. He will not rebuke you for asking. Don't you love that? That he won't be like, hey, stop asking, or you know what, that's stupid. No. Ask for wisdom. I want you to all picture the angels in heaven wearing shirts that say, got wisdom? Then I want you to picture God wearing the same shirt saying, got wisdom, but with this added phrase, start here. Model your starting point for wisdom. Leave that legacy. The first source of wisdom, the wisdom of God. The second source of wisdom, the wisdom from life experience. How many times have you said, I'll never do that again? Or how many times will you say, I'll never let that happen to me again? The longer you live, the more life experience you have. The book of Job in the Old Testament wrote about this idea by asking two questions. Listen to this. Job 12:12 says, is not wisdom found among the aged? Does not long life bring understanding? There are some experiences you don't want your children to ever experience. Am I right? You don't want anybody to experience that. There are paths, roads, that life paths. You're like, please don't go down that way. I've been there. And they may not understand it, but it's sharing those life experiences. Please don't go that route. It's just a dead end, and I've been there, and I don't want you to go down that route. I don't want you to feel the hurt that I did. I don't want you to feel the pain that I have. One author wrote this about a mom's legacy of wisdom. Listen, it says, a mother's wisdom is rooted in her experience and her love for her children. A mother's wisdom is a voice that echoes in the hearts long after she's gone. A mother's wisdom is the voice of reason that guides us when we're lost. A mother's wisdom is a legacy that lives on through her children. First source of wisdom, the wisdom of God. Second source of wisdom, the wisdom from life experience. The third source of wisdom, wisdom from the wise. Is everybody still with me? Just say yes. Okay, Proverbs 15:22 explains this so well. Plans fail for lack of counsel, but with many advisors they succeed. Listen to Proverbs 13:20 says, walk with the what? Wise, and become wise, for a companion of fools suffers harm. Listen, it's okay to model your choice to seek out other counsel, whether it's in a trusted friend, leader, or professional. Let your humility shine. It's okay to say, you know what? I need help. I need to go ask somebody else. I need to go see a professional. I need to find somebody with more experience than I have. And figure out, okay, you know what, that man, you've been through it, or man, those words I never would have thought of came from you. But you want to seek out someone else. You want to seek out somebody wise. Tap into wise wisdom. God has given us the blessing of in-person counsel that can help us move through life. And isn't gleaning wisdom from others a baton you want to pass on to the younger generation? I hope so. So we get back to the question. We want to make this so smooth, the transition to the next generation. What's on the baton? And are you making it smooth? Are you making it ambiguous? Are you making it like they don't know what you're passing on, or what they're passing on is hurting them? And you're like, I got to stop this. I got to pass on the right baton. What is encompassed in your baton? Men, you're not excluded from this. What are you passing on to the next generation? Is it your attitude of the world? Is it your bitterness? Is it, what are you passing on? Is it that you love God and that's the best baton they can have to pass on? Whatever it is. I hope you're encouraged today just to pass the baton by sharing a legacy of memories. That's God's faithfulness. The stories that mold you, living a legacy of commitment to the Lord. How important is Jesus to you? And expressing a legacy of wisdom, pointing to the next generation, to the resources God has made available. Make what you're passing on, everyone, so obvious that it's unmistakable. It's this red. That when I pass away, when moms pass away, I know what my mom passed on to me. I'm the living legacy of that. And my friends, I stand up here today because her relationship with the Lord inspired me. And now I stand here before you with whipped cream on. No, I'm kidding. As we close, I want to do this. I just want all the women to stand. Would you do that for me? Just all the women. I'm going to pray for you. God, we honor these women. Whatever title they have, they are still an influence on people, this younger generation. God, wherever they are in their life, if there's a broken relationship, is a great relationship, or God, your adoptive mom, or you're just an influencer, or a teacher, God, I pray that they would pass this baton on, so no matter who they're with, it is so obvious. It's a red baton. And God, they would look at them and say, hey, that person's different. So God, I pray for these women that you would empower them, you would encourage them, you would inspire them. And God, that the men that are in their lives would spur them on.
God, that they wouldn't just be sitting there and being on a bleacher, but they would be people who say, you know what? I love the legacy you're leaving for our children. God, I pray that you'd be with them today. I pray to God that they'd be honored today. And God, what a blessing. And God, I pray for those relationships that are stuck. Lord, only you can change people's hearts. God, help us to learn how to respond to that. Not react, respond. God, I pray that we go to you to wisdom, use the resources available. Thank you for these incredible women we have here this morning. And we pray this all in Jesus' name, amen. Would you have a seat? After this song, I wanna invite all of the women. We have a homemade gifts for you out there waiting for you. And keys to brand new cars. You want to run out there to get the... We just have a gift for you. We want to continue celebrating you. So after the service, please head out there and you will see a big setup there for you. And we want that gift to be for you.
I don't mind if you got something nice to say about me. I enjoy an accolade like the rest. You could take my picture, hang it in a gallery. All the who's who's and so-and-so's used to be the best at such and such. It wouldn't matter much. I won't lie, it feels
Well, ladies, do you feel encouraged? I hope you do. Men, are you still with me? Have a great Mother's Day, everyone. Ladies, don't forget, there's a gift out there for you. Have a fantastic Sunday. I'll see you next week.